getting close to the end of road construction. We still have mitigation projects to do after this, but basically, from a planning standpoint, you know, we look at some of the needs out here, and if you look on the back page of the notes I gave you, that's kind of the purpose and need. You know, you can see the shore has eroded literally right up to where the old highway was. So we had waves that were crashing over. I mean, the picture there is in front of our environmental document, the car coming under the wave there. So on the average, this area had been, the bluff had been receding on the average of about 5 feet a year. Not regularly, but I mean, one year you might lose 20 feet, one year you might have lost hardly any. But it's been, this is probably the worst location right here where those cypress trees are. The worst case for the erosion. So what we did is we took a 3 mile stretch here and we looked at how can we keep the road open, because the road serves a lot of people, a lot of great areas in Big Sur, and it's a 200 mile detour if you close. So we looked at different things over the years. We did very short-term solutions. We put rock. That bluff right there used to be protected with $1 billion worth of rock, just to keep it from taking out the highway. And then we did a couple smaller little detours where we could, until we could get the whole project done. And now the whole project, the long-term solution, was moving the highway far enough. In deciding how far to move it, we could have gone into a whole scientific study about littoral cells and storm intensities and storm directions and all that, and that would have took a long time. So So what we did is we basically used aerial photos for the last 65 years. How far, where's the bluff going? How far do we need to move it back? And so worked out to, we wanted to get about 100 years of life out of the highway, so we moved it approximately 500 years up to 500 feet back. So a place like this, it's a beautiful place. So when we're planning a project like this, it's all about context. And so as far as context, we did an inventory of all the environment out here, all the natural resources, the beautiful views. And then the other part of context is the regulatory side, all the people that we've got to deal with, the commissions and permit agencies, local businesses and property owners. So that's all part of the context that we considered out there. As far as biological species here, we've had to deal with plant species, fish species, including steelhead, gobies. Recent addition to this area is elephant seals, and how we would impact the elephant seals. We had a lot of invasive species that were planted here for the purpose of keeping erosion down, so they planted ice plant out here to keep the, you know, hold the sand down and stuff. The visual, of course, is an incredible place to look at, both whether you're looking at the ocean or you're looking at the hills. So, state parks, this land, this motel here, when we started the project, was private ownership. Eventually, the Land Conservancy purchased it and then moved it over to state parks. So state parks has this piece, and they've got plans for this. They're going to put a hostel in here, which is nice because there's not another one for, I think, maybe even Santa Cruz. So I think they've got, that's what they're going to plan for this motel, and then they're looking at maybe a campground in here too.
What are they
looking
for here?
Hostel. For travel, you know, cheap place to stay.
Yeah.
Yeah, if you're backpacking or bike riding through, place to stay.
Hotel,
and then maybe a campground out here. I think they've got an environmental document out now about their campground. So in developing this project, you can see kind of the list there. We have about 12 governmental agencies that we had to deal with on here, including Army Corps, California Fish and Game, now Fish and Wildlife, U.S. Fish and Wildlife, SHPO for historic resources, NOAA, who has the National Marine Fisheries, as well as a marine sanctuary. All offshore here is a marine sanctuary. There's also a state marine reserve run by Fish and Game, or jurisdiction of Fish and Game. Army Corps, BLM, actually, because they own the lighthouse. And so...
Jody was going to join us, but she's too busy, so we're going to go see her after we're done here.
Okay, yeah, they just took a tour, quite a big tour of them. And then we have, other stakeholders here, including residents. The house that we're using right there is a construction office. So there used to be a total of four houses there. And we've taken one down. We're going to take the one you see there down once we're done with construction. There's one remaining residence and then another house just to the north of that we own as well. And we may either use that as a construction maintenance type office, or maybe we'll sell it off. I don't know exactly what the plan is there yet. And then all the land around you was owned by the Hearst Corporation. It's like 88,000 acres, about 10 miles of land here that was in private ownership. One of the things that worked out on this project, and from a planning standpoint, was they had plans to do conservation efforts out here. And as part of that, they put all the land to the east of the highway into a conservation easement. Kept a few parcels for themselves, and then everything west of the highway got transferred to state parks. So all the land out here, which used to be private, you can now go on without any permission because it's now part of state parks. And then they gave us a 500 foot strip of land to move the highway as many times as we need to, and then all the land west of the new highway becomes state park land as well. So from a planning standpoint, that was a great deal. It really reduced our right-of-way costs on this project, and it was a win-win for the state, people, and the Hearst Corporation.
And what year was that? That was like 20...
It was in 2005.
Okay. Yeah.
And so, at that time, we still didn't have an environmental document for this project, but the right-of-way efforts there worked out, so we did finally have an environmental document to just get right into the studies and final design. So you can see kind of where the old highway was. And, John, the last time you were here, we still hadn't gotten into all of this yet, but you can kind of see the strip of land along the coast here where the old highway was. Over there where that end dump is, that's where the rocks were. That's the location of that picture that you've got. Now the worst location for the erosion. So what we're doing now is we're kind of restoring the old highway, make it look more natural to fit into the surroundings, and then it'll get planted with grass, native grasses. So to come up with the alignment, I mean, there was about 13 different options we had for moving the highway. I think actually one of the alternatives went way out behind the houses. Early on, we thought, well, should we plan on just building a causeway on the ocean, because the waves were, the erosion was so bad. But there was about 13 different options, so we got down to two, and then we finally selected the alignment here, which you see. It's alignment two on here, the orange line. And it's the more curvilinear one, the two that we finally got down to, this orange one and the blue. And so, what we had to consider in moving that was safety, of course, the waves crashing over, trying to get a 100-year minimum design life, approximately. And then we've got lots of design standards. I mean, it's a scenic highway, but people still drive 55 plus out here. So we have to make sure they're accommodated.
Plus.
We wanted the vertical alignment to kind of match the surrounding terrain, so And if you look at the highway, it kind of lays pretty well along this parade. It's got even the bridges. We've got three bridges out here that really don't stick up out of the ground. Everything's below, so it worked out pretty good. We had to buy property. We had PG&E lines and AT&T lines that had to be moved. And then, since it's such a pristine area, lots of biological resources, we had a lot of mitigation to do. So we were looking at how can we mitigate. There's not a lot of area to mitigate on site because a lot of it was still pretty good, pretty natural conditions. So we had to find locations to mitigate. And I'll talk about that in a little bit.
So just real quick, we haven't talked about that very much, but right, the idea is first avoid the impact if you at all can. Reduce the impact, but at some point you just can't, right? If you have to realign the freeway, you have to realign the freeway. So the mitigation is this notion of trying to take out the bad stuff and counteract it with some good stuff, either in place or somewhere else, so that if we're talking about extent of habitat, if we lost 2 acres, the idea is you'd create 2 acres more, or maybe a bit more than that if we can't make perfect habitat. But that's the idea of mitigation.
And the other part of mitigation, in this case, was about public access. And so we had to think about, you know, what's the public do when they're out here? I mean, what are their needs getting to the coast, still wanting to get to the ocean? What are they looking at? Where do they, you know, they got vehicles, so where are they gonna park? And then we had to think about our construction methods. Our construction methods, it have a lot to do with how the land is impacted. And in this case, that $1 million worth of rock all had to come out, okay? So we had to figure out how are we gonna do that without getting equipment out in the water, without, you know, you've gotta maintain this equipment and it's got oil dripping and all that kind of stuff. How are we gonna do that? So, and all that was part of regulatory through our coastal permit. There's a lot of conditions there. So we had to consider that. So when we got into the project and into the environmental phase, we started getting to the environmental document. There's two basic laws that govern us. One is the National Environmental Policy Act at the federal level. And then that law requires that we study all the environmental effects of our actions and have a pretty good disclosure to the public about what those impacts will be. In this case, we ended up with an environmental assessment and a finding of no significant impact because of the mitigation methods that we used out here to reduce the impacts. And then there's CEQA, the California Environmental Quality Act. And Caltrans was the lead agency because we had such a big part of the project here. That's another disclosure document required by California law. And some of the requirements are different between NEPA and CEQA. And so the highest level document in NEPA would have been an environmental impact statement if we couldn't mitigate appropriately under federal law. Under CEQA, we did an environmental impact report, which is the highest level document, saying we're going to have impacts that can't be fully mitigated. And so we did an EIR. Once we got out of the environmental phase and into the design phase, we have permitting. This whole area is full of wetlands, and even now where you don't see a lot of standing water, there's wetlands out here. This area in between the old road and the new road where these culverts come out is a sort of wetland. There's lots of jurisdictions that govern wetlands, including the Army Corps, California Fish and Wildlife, and then Coastal Commission. They all have a little bit different definition of what a wetland is. So this area is pretty wet most of the year. We have three creeks that run through the area that are wetlands. We've got some kind of springs and vernal pools that the water is just subsurface and just slowly moving subsurface. And then, of course, the ocean. So we had to go through permitting with Army Corps, the Regional Water Quality Control Board, Fish and Game, Coastal Commission,
on and on.
National Marine Sanctuary, Fish and Wildlife Service, NIMS because of the fish, and areas off the coast here are owned by the State Lands Commission, state land, the State Land Commission controls what goes on just off the shore. So we had a lot of permits to do. Probably the hardest one to get was our coastal development permit. And that coastal kind of has their fingers in all of the laws, everybody's jurisdiction. So that was a tough permit to get.
So you'd agree that the Coastal Commission is one of the strongest, highest hurdles, maybe we could say it that way, to get over.
It is. And a big part of that is because they have a very difficult regulatory environment. They have to deal with making sure people have public access to the coast. I mean, that's kind of where they started out with public access. But they also are concerned with the natural resources. And so they have a tough job, and in some cases, like in this project, they have to balance public access with the natural resources. And so in this case, we couldn't mitigate everything, but we provided money towards a coastal trail, which will be built within the project limits to make sure people can get here. And then we've done an awful lot of mitigation on the biology side, and that we're still going to do. So, I'll get into a little bit about the mitigation. Mitigation, like Sean said, is first you avoid, then you try to reduce and minimize, and then when you can't do that, then you have to go create something potentially. So in this case, the old roadbed, for the most part, is getting restored to a more natural state. There's places where we had to cross a wetland, where the water was just subsurface water, not so much groundwater, but just water that slowly migrates on the surface there. We provided what we called it a burrito wrap, but basically it's crushed rock, subbase, where water can migrate under the roadway and can keep both sides of the wetland connected. So we've done that at several locations along the way. We've done some contour grading, and this slope over here where that car just passed, right now you can see the cut. But what we did at the top is just round it off. So once it's vegetated and it's grown in, it's not going to look like this just sharp cut. It's going to look like kind of the knoll that was there before. So on site, we're doing a lot of the restoration. We're doing the wetland mitigation. We're creating some wetlands in here that will be protected in perpetuity by our Army Corps permit. As I said, we couldn't mitigate everything. Some of the things that we couldn't mitigate are coastal prairie, because there's really no other place to go. And so what happens is you have a mitigation ratio. So wetlands and coastal prairie, we might have mitigated at 3-1. So for every acre of impact, we had to provide 3 acres of mitigation. And that's to ensure that when everything, if things die off or things happen in that area in the future, you at least have what you had before. So you do more than what you need. At the area, remember the project, it's up here. Our project ends at Arroyo de la Cruz. There's a big bridge across there. There's an area just north of there that used to be farmed prior to the Hearst Corporation. Then when the Hearst Corporation owned it, they redirected the water so that they could do some farming there. And so that's no longer used that way. And so what we're going to do is we're going to go in and create wetlands out there. And so what we're going to do, which is now it's pretty flat and we have water kind of directed around, we're going to go out there and do kind of like a golf course kind of grading to create little ponds. We're going to bring in some clay to mix with the soil so it holds water longer in the year. And there's one little stream in there. We're digging down in the water hole to make it deep enough to hold water longer so that California red-legged frogs can breed in there. We did have one area, there's a bridge just north of that knoll there, that had a little breeding area for California red-legged frogs. We didn't fully disturb it, but we did have to put a bridge pier kind of in a little high spot between the two channels in. So that requires some mitigation, so we're going to do that up at the north end. Some of the things that we had to think about was, you know, you can't work in the drainages between in the winter months when they're the flow. So in June through October, we can't. That's when we have to do our work. And so we had to schedule the work in those areas. At the bridges, we have pile driving that had to be occurred. And the vibration, when you're even you're not necessarily in the stream, but when you're close by, there's enough groundwater that the vibration can get out and disturb the animals that are living in that area. So we had to figure out how to reduce our pile driving. For the big piers, we actually drilled big holes down and put rebar cages and filled with concrete rather than pile driving. So we minimized our pile driving to just temporary structures to build the bridges from. And then, of course, I mentioned the Coastal Trail. We provided $1.4 million to State Parks, who is actually going to operate the Coastal Trail. And so in between the old road and the new road is where they're going to build their trail. They're in the process now of designing that. Some places are going to use the old road. Here we left part of the old road in front of the hotel that will be part of the Coastal Trail. At the south end, there was an area where people would park along the side of the road to go surfing. There's a great beach down there, so we're providing a parking area for about 20 vehicles down there. At the north end of the project, up here near Arroyo de la Cruz, there's an area where people used to informally park there. And our permit from Coastal to make sure there was public access and access to the Coastal Trail required a parking area that provided at least 30 vehicles, expandable to 90 vehicles. So we're building it for 60, and then when we're done with construction, that area will become part of the state park, and they will operate the parking area. But all that is to make sure that people have access to the coast, in this area of the coast. So once we got into construction, there were things that popped up. on here.
And what year did construction start?
It started in May of 2015, and so it took a little over two and a half years to do the work. The house that we took down had nesting birds, and then we found bats. Bats are beneficial to the environment. So we had to, by hand, go and pop the shingles off to make sure the bats were clear before we took the house down. And same with the birds. There's a lot of swallows were nesting. When we got into construction, right before winter, it wasn't even winter yet, we had some big waves that brought water in over the sandbar at the creek down here. And boy, the elephant seals loved it. There was like their backyard pool. I mean, we had elephant seals in there like crazy, and it was gonna potentially disturb our bridge construction. So we had to have some experts from the Marine,
Marine Mammal Center?
Marine Mammal Center, and help us kind of escort the elephant seals out of the water once it started raining and the sandbar was breached.
Respectfully.
Yeah. And then we put, kind of cages over the inlets and the culverts so that they couldn't get back in there. But that's something we hadn't planned on. Right? So on elephant seals now, we're putting fences out here to try to keep them away from areas where state parks doesn't want them, so we're doing that now in construction as well. The rock removal, like I said, that was an awful lot of rock to get rid of.
What was the amount again?
What's that?
What was the amount of rock?
You know, I don't recall the exact amount, but it was probably a half mile. Not quite half mile. Maybe a third of a mile of rock all along there. You know, about 20 feet high. Big triangle of rock out there. So we had to figure out how to get that rock out of there and work with a contractor on a plan that was acceptable to Coastal Commission. And they did it. They ended up was doing is they flattened the rock out as they went down and created a flat surface, and using backhoes, they picked all the rock up and moved it and on the trucks. Well, then what do you do with it? Our contract basically made it the contractor's property once they moved it. Mud Creek Slide came along, and hey, they had a big need for a lot of rock. So that kind of worked out. And it took a lot of rock up there.
You had to buy it from them then, right?
Well, you know, we paid to put it in, we paid to take it out, and we're paying to put it back in.
Was there any, like, looking into how much emissions there were during the rock removal?
How
like
much what?
Emissions from, like, fuel, like, with all the tractors and, like...
We analyzed that in the environmental doc. We've got a section that talks about greenhouse gases and construction emissions.
Oh, okay.
And for this area, it's in attainment, so there's not an issue with air quality. What we did have to worry about was making sure that when they were refueling, they did it away so that any fuel didn't end up in the water, oil dripping, they had to maintain their vehicles and that kind of thing. So, not a lot, but you know, just kind of basic common sense to make sure no hydrocarbons got out.
Okay.
Utilities, PG&E had prior rights out here, so we for our coastal development permit, we had to underground all the utilities. That costs about $1.5 million, almost $2 million to do. Take them, you know, give them rights along the highway and bury all their lines. These lines you see here are all coming down. They'll be underground. We're providing some money for state parks to make their electrical going into the buildings to be able to hook up for the underground lines. An interesting thing that we had come up during construction was all our seeding, we put compost down. Right, and compost is regulated in California as far as content of contaminants in there, and the laws are made such that one, there's people able to compost, you know, feasibly, economically, and be able to make a profit at it, and it also works with people who produce have the materials that need to be composted, okay? And first thing you think about is probably like lumber mills where they've got all the sawdust and everything and that kind of stuff is composted. Well, the other thing that gets composted is when you go to a supermarket and some of the vegetables go bad and they're in plastic and they just throw everything into a bin and it goes off to a composter.
Even the plastic?
Even the plastic. So there's limits on how much plastic can go in, right? Now, the plastic that goes in there is you know, the little bags, they're real thin film, right? So the composition can be, is by weight, is what the, you know, they try to come up with an allowable weight of stuff in compost. Well, when we put compost out here, and once all the little plastic dried off, it rolled off, rolled up and blew in the wind. And suddenly you have little piles of plastic. So we went out and had the contractor with vacuums vacuum up a lot of that. And then we had to work with the compost industry. How can we get cleaner compost? And you know, if they had to separate all that out, it's a big burden and maybe you won't have anybody composting anymore. So there's an effort now to look at compost methods and what's going into the compost. So that was an interesting thing that we didn't expect. A requirement, just because of the area that we're in, that anything that we, any seed that we use was native to this area, okay? So we had, the contractor had subcontracted out here collecting seed for use when we needed it to reseed. And they couldn't find enough. I mean, we had 5 years of drought and there was near enough seed. So now we've got some mitigation projects that are going to come up. We're growing the seed. They've collected some seed. They're going to go to greenhouses grow plants, collect the seed, grow more plants, collect the seeds, so that we have an adequate seed supply to do our mitigation sites up north of the road to La Cruz. So that's been interesting. So the good part about that is we know the seed is from this area. It's kind of grown in a greenhouse environment, not so much contamination from outside sources. We'll use that also to grow some of the plants and grass mats that we'll put out here in some of the riparian areas. And it's kind of been quite a learning experience, this project, working in a pristine area like this. So I'll kind of leave it there. Any questions you had, I'm glad to answer.